Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Season 5, Episode 11 of Bell to Bell with Bobby Blaze. This is going to be our Halloween episode. So we were thinking of calling it Jeremy and Bobby Meet Frankenstein, but I couldn't get a Frankenstein on. So I am your host, Dr. Jeremy Fever, and joining us now, Bobby Flytrap.
And I'm not too far from downtown Cincinnati. Hey, Professor, why did a ghost go into the bar?
He was looking for booze.
Exactly. Ba-boom.
Oh, fuck.
This
I'm sorry.
The 70s, people.
I wasn't trying to actually step on your joke there. I thought I was just throwing out something funny.
Oh, no. I thought we were working.
Oh.
This WKRP, where we at?
Oh. Well, you know, it's
zone. I know you like to have fun around Halloween. I know it's a big deal for you around
Halloween. Yeah, yeah, it is.
Yeah, we have some fun with it.
Yeah, I love horror movies. Ever since I was a little kid, and it's just one of those things I always come back to. I do, you know, I have scared myself a time or two with the kind of shit that I watch, though. So I do got to be careful. But I also, one of the things I appreciate is special effects, practical special effects done well. Now, the reason I like that is because I got a little bit of a bloodlust, and I also like watching violent things happen. And so this week, we're talking about most gruesome moments and matches.
That's right, man. You know, we went back, we threw in for a swerve our first season. Actually, we did top 10 scary movies or horror movies of all time. So go back and check that one out. We did bloodiest matches, I think, and also scariest gimmicks before. And this week we thought, man, we're going to do some gruesome matches and moments, man. And some of these I cringe at, I tell you.
Yeah.
I do the same thing. I went by memory. Then I went, you know, just kind of talked to the professor here about a couple of them. And then I was on the internet about a couple of them, and I was like, this is going to be gruesome for me, but probably fun for Jeremy. But we're going to have fun with it anyway. We dug deep for some of this stuff, I tell you. Some of it's just right there, right in front of you, though, too. So we hope you like it. It's kind of a out-of-context top 10, but it will kind of run it that way, if I'm not mistaken. Right, Professor?
Yeah, basically. We're going to run it like a list, but
yeah.
You know, it's really just in the order we kind of want to talk about it.
Right.
Yeah. You know what? Let's maybe talk about some things that you shouldn't do when you're doing gruesome matches.
Yeah. We had a couple of we thought about mentioning, and some of these things should be doing some of these things anyway, people. It's supposed to be professional wrestling here.
Yeah. Well, you know, let's go ahead and let's say that. Like, this whole list is shit you shouldn't do.
Yeah.
But as a company, these next three things are bad things that shouldn't have been done ever.
Right.
And
the first one, I'm going to put this one out there because I'm going to let you do the second one. But that first one, I you had to refresh my memory on it. I kept seeing pictures of Abdullah the Butcher, who we just finished up a couple of weeks ago about, you know, the madman from Sudan. And I kept seeing him in this electric chair, and I knew it was from something from WCW. And I think you said it went back to an older Halloween Scream or something. Havoc.
I think it was Halloween Havoc 91. Now,
91, yeah.
You don't flog me if I got it wrong, though, because, you know, sometimes it's a little slippery.
No, I'm going by what you're saying. I believe it's around that time period. But this, you can't, realistically. And we're trying to keep this as realistic as possible because some of these things we're going to talk about that are gruesome were real and they really did happen.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you're going to a wrestling show and there's a big cage within a cage and then it's got an electric chair in the middle and you're expecting someone to be electrocuted or killed on live TV in front of a live audience that night, I mean, that's just going too far. That's just something you shouldn't do. Is that the process we're trying to think here?
That is certainly where I come from.
Yeah.
You know, there's these things where they've hanged people from the neck, from a cage, crucified. Mm-hmm. You know, you talk about, like, I don't know, they leave like an 8-pound fucking sledgehammer in the ring. Well, you cannot pick up an 8-pound hammer and do anything with it that wouldn't be a kill shot, besides that bullshit hand over the end. And let me tell you, I've used sledgehammers to drive lots of metal stakes in the ground, and that would not work. That is not how you use a hammer.
No, that's not how you do it.
So
it's also not how you put a stake through a vampire's heart either.
No, it is not. boy, you got to be real careful about how you do that.
Yeah.
You should ask my old friend Carl Kolchak about that sometime.
There's your reference. Throwback.
Yep.
Wow. That's a good one, man. You know, that was on Netflix for a while.
You know what? It is on it. If you go to NBC's new free streaming platform, every episode is on there, I think.
Okay, cool. Thanks. Yeah.
And those, and the first two were great, by the way. So yeah.
Deal.
But so there are things you don't do. You don't put a gun in there. You don't put a knife in there. You don't put a weapon that can't be used in there. You don't put a goddamn electric chair in the middle of the room. Right.
That's the point right there.
Yeah. That to me is just ridiculous. Look, I know, even when I thought wrestling was completely legit, I know you're not going to kill a guy.
Yeah.
I know that's not going to happen. And all you do when you pretend to kill somebody is make me go, well, that was, look, every time The Undertaker died, you know, and I'm just like, oh, come on, guys. This,
yeah. Not why Coyote out there at the Roadrunner, you know. Anyway, so we got another one coming up. I guess this was the here recently with an eye injury. Cause we're going to talk about a real one that took place. But I guess they did an eye spot with Rey Mysterio Jr. Was that with Roman? Was that with who was that? Reigns?
I think it was Seth Rollins.
Seth Rollins. Yeah. Okay. You told me that, and I forgot actually. So they did a deal. I think you brought it up before. Was it a ping pong ball or something that was painted like an eyeball?
Fuck, I don't. You know what? Here's the thing. I don't know how they did it, but I did see a still from it, and I wouldn't have bought that in a $50 horror film. You know, I wouldn't have bought that in the lowest budget of horror films. And I suspend my disbelief when I watch these super indie productions.
Yeah,
like I watch such cheaply made horror films. I'm not happy unless I see a boom mic swing through the shot most of the time, you know?
Yeah. But you, if you're going to have an eye for an eye match, I guess is what they had. I mean, and expect someone to actually get their eye, you know, legitimately pulled out. You know, that's just not, you already know what you're paying for when you buy it, I guess. Mm-hmm. I don't know. But I'm not interested in that because I know that's not going to happen. Now in a horror film, you know, sure, I expect, you know, eyeball smashed and everything to happen, you know, and that's fine. If it's cheaply made, I know what I'm watching.
Yeah, exactly. If I go into, look, I went through a real nasty short period of the worst horror films you could find on Amazon, and literally, I would call you sometimes. So I'm like, hey, did you know Al Snow did a fucking horror movie about a fat camp?
Yeah, you was finding some dandies.
There were some gems when I was doing that. But, you know, they were doing this thing at the WWE. I want to give them points for doing something that hadn't been tried. You know, the cinematic matches. The problem is for guys like us, we want a real gritty fucking match in an arena with a live camera that's moving around the ring. We don't want you rubbing our face in the fact that we're watching a phony sport. We want to watch the match and enjoy it in that moment and not be condescended to. But at the same time, I'm saying all this, you know, wrestling's going to have to go through some changes now, and at least they tried something new.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure.
So, I mean, I'm kind of damning with faint praise is what I'm doing here, I guess.
I got you. We got one more example of what not to do, and that's work with children, babies, and animals, I guess. Mm-hmm. Is that safe to say?
Yeah.
I'm not sure which year it was, but there was a wasn't a dog collar match.
It dog
was
a kennel.
Match, yeah. Dog kennel match with Boss Man and Al Snow, and I guess the dogs just shit the bed, basically, literally. Couple of them took a shit, I guess. They're supposed to be real vicious outside the ring. I don't think they were. I guess a couple of them might have been fornicating. I don't know.
Well, that's probably the most vicious thing they did, you know?
Yeah, so not a dig towards our Boss Man, but, you know, working with the animals there, didn't go over that one. So there's about three examples of some things that we're not going to kind of be talking about this week, because most of these, I think, on our list are real and really did happen. I think we probably, since we was talking about eyeball, let's just start with that one, then go down our list there, Jeremy, because there was legit eyeball injury. I know one of the Samoans got an eyeball pulled out and pushed it back in. Mm-hmm. He pushed a strand of hair behind it. Oh, and he had to pull the hair out from behind it too. Now, I'm not sure who he was wrestling in that match, but I know you're going to tell us about someone else that lost an eye in a match. So go ahead.
Yeah. So it was Stan Hansen versus Vader. And Bobby, did you ever work with Vader, or were you around him at all?
You know what? I never was around him.
Okay.
Never met him.
Apparently, he had a reputation for working really, really snug.
Yeah.
So a lot of guys didn't want to wrestle him. Well, Stan Hansen don't give a fuck.
Right.
As a matter of fact, Stan Hansen takes his glasses off so that way he can throw as hard as he wants and everybody gives him an excuse for it. But he started walloping Vader in the side of the head and popped Vader's eye clean out.
Jeez.
And I think if I remember reading about this right, like Vader's eye is like hanging there for a second. And Vader's like, "You knocked my fucking eye out." and then he pushes it back in and continues the match. If I remember everything right,
but, I think that's the way it is.
Yeah.
So.
Jesus Christ, you know?
Yeah. And that's getting walloped aside the head when you get your eye.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I saw a lady get kicked by a horse, and that happened one time in my life.
Oh, my God.
And I never want to see anything like that again. So don't, if you're around horses, never approach them from behind.
No.
Never. No. Oh, Jesus Christ. And I can tell you, Stan Hansen will hit you in the head as hard as a horse kicks. So I probably even now, you know. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah,
we'll bring up another match that Vader was in where Cactus Jack famously lost his ear across the cable, right? I guess his ear was on a rope the way he was trapped in there some way. And it was with Vader. I think it was in Germany or something. And Cactus Jack, like, lost part of his ear. Is that correct?
You know what? Here's the thing. I think you're right. I think his head got caught between the ropes.
Yeah.
But I know that when I heard the story, and I've never actually gone back to double check this because I don't like seeing people lose body parts.
Yeah.
I had heard originally that it was a barbed wire rope match. Now, I don't know if that was the case because I only went and saw one time where there was like some outside the ring footage of it.
Yeah.
And I want to say in my memory it was ropes, but the way it was told to me initially, it was barbed wire.
My memory serves me correct. It was actually inside the ring, and the ring ropes, you know, just, you know, had to wire through them with the covering, of course. Mm-hmm. It was so tight, and we pulled out at this point, as, you know, ripped his ear off.
Oh, yeah. Well,
you know, I guess he was trying to be like Mark Chopper Breeden there and cutting his ears off to get out of the penitentiary or whatever.
Yeah.
Or maybe a Tarantino movie where you'll never listen to a certain song again in a certain way when you see someone's ear getting cut off.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I can't imagine being in a ring at night and Cactus Jack's ear just get ripped off. It'd be just horrible, man.
Well, here's the thing that nobody really talks about. It's real easy to remove an ear from somebody's head. They will come. You jerk on them, they will come right off. That's why if you ever get into a fist fight that you cannot fucking avoid, go ahead and slap them with your offhand right across the ear and then grab a hold of it.
Damn.
Yeah.
You're getting all technical here.
Well, here's the thing, Bobby. I was never a big guy, you know. I was always kind of like long and lanky. I mean, now that I'm older, I'm 215 pounds. But when I was younger, I had to keep everybody as fucking far from me as I could if I wanted to stand a chance. So I learned real easily what you do is you hit, touch, and grab, and hit again. You don't waste any motion. If you throw your arm out, there's a real good chance that somebody's going to get a hold of it and break your hand or your elbow. So you need to make sure that you strike something, get a hold of something, and then follow that up with another shot. And then get the fuck out of there. That's my whole...
We was talking about ears being lost here, and Jeremy's talking about cupping a damn person's ear stuck in the middle of fuse ringing through my head right now thinking about that scene. But you was mentioning the way you had heard that story, that the ropes could have been like a barbed wire fence or a barbed wire chain around the ring. That's some of the things too that we've just kind of touched on. We're going from thing to thing here. I think that was only two ear things we was going to talk about, but also we've heard about, you know, these crazy matches where people have light bulbs and barbed wire ropes, exploding water, exploding boards, all kinds of different things there. We went from the electric chair, but we're going to keep on talking about some more gruesome injuries as well. Is there anything really bizarre that you heard? I think you told me one that had this real long, the guy went through this, like try to do everything because of neon lights and all that.
Oh, it was, yeah, it was Joey Janela. I don't remember who it was against, but they're on top of a building. Okay. So first you got to get that. They're on top of like a warehouse or something.
Yeah.
Below them and probably about 8 feet away, I'm guessing, because that would be how you'd have to jump to hit that, is a pickup truck that has lumber and fluorescent bulbs and shit stacked up through it. And whoever he was wrestling got him up for a standard pile driver, leapt off the building and pile drove him through the bulbs, the whatever the lumbers. I'm guessing it was probably plywood separated by 2x4, so that way you'd have something to, you know, crash beneath you. But it was off the top of a building, through light bulbs, into a truck bed, through wood. That is just, you know, when you had to write a list of all the shit you've got going on, you've gone a little too far.
Yeah, that just sounds like stupidity to me, man, to do that, you know. I'll tell you one of the most gruesome things I saw, man, and I watched it live, and I got sick to my stomach. And that was when Big Sid Vicious broke his leg out in Indianapolis. I guess he was on the second rope, if I'm not mistaken, in the Steiners. And the only thing kind of, you know, Sid's, you know, dropped people, not intentionally, I don't think, maybe just being carelessly on her head and stuff from power bombs and choke slams, et cetera. And supposedly he didn't want to take his move. And I guess he was going to jump in the second rope down, and then Scott was going to, if I understood it correct, I think he was going to catch him and do a belly-to-belly, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, his head had dropped off the second rope, from my understanding. But when he did, I don't even go back and watch it, man. The first couple of times was enough to turn my stomach. But his leg just snaps like a matchstick when he hits the ring. And that's just, again, to me, that's just one of the most gruesome things I've ever seen, you know, in the wrestling. Well, and I think it happened in Indianapolis, if I'm not mistaken.
I'm looking at a still photo of right afterwards, and his leg at the mid, what do you call that part of the leg now? I can't even think. But the bottom of his leg, the calf, is bent sideways at about 85 degrees.
Yeah.
And it's just God damn, it is just nasty. Nasty. Yeah. I think I saw that one as it was happening, or like...
You probably did. I did.
And that was, that was just weird, because you're like, holy shit.
Yeah.
Because he didn't fall far.
No, he just basically stepped off the second rope, if I remember correctly, was going to jump down off the second rope. I think the way it should have been, his feet should have hit, and as soon as he hit, Steiner was going to be there, you know, belly to belly, and then take him over. It wasn't like a big, you know, big move or anything.
Yeah.
But when he hit, obviously, his leg snapped, you know. So anyway, it's gruesome. Let's talk about one that we both was talking about recently. We're going to give him a 3-for-1, I think.
Yeah.
Some of the stuff we've seen and heard, this didn't happen real recently, but due to the Dark Side of the Ring episodes, we all got to revisit these things happening here recently. And that is, New Jack. And tell us about a couple of things, this guy did, man. Well, that was just, gruesome stuff.
Well, he tried to kill Vic Grimes by throwing him off of a scaffold. And if you watch Vic Grimes come off that scaffold and hit the ring and bounce and hit the ropes,
Yeah.
He looks like he's fucking dead.
Yeah, I don't know how he didn't die.
I don't know, because, I mean, that was a far enough fall that he could have broken his neck or back real fucking easy, especially with that bounce at the end.
Yeah.
So that was just disgusting to look at.
Yeah. Hated that.
Yeah. There was a time that New Jack stabbed the shit out of Gypsy Joe.
Yeah. Now I've watched the footage of that, and he just took him around a ring and just dug and dug and dug into his head, stabbing him repeatedly in the head, man. And I think Gypsy Joe was, 72, 73 years old when it took place. You know, somewhere up in... at a school in West Virginia, if I'm not mistaken. It wasn't a very big show, I don't think. Fan-wise, you know, I don't know how they built it up or whatever, but damn, man. And I know Gypsy Joe's got a hard head and was a tough old son of a gun, you know, is not going to sell anything. And I guess Jack, I don't know if he took advantage of him or just was why he was doing it that, you know, to that extreme, but it was just gruesome to see. You know, him, Gypsy Joe, getting his head busted open like that. Just gruesome.
I don't know why anybody works with New Jack, honestly.
Yeah.
I don't get it, you know, because it's just time after time. And look at the mass transit thing, which he clipped that dude's artery in his face.
Well, that's what I was going to say. He shreds a man, you know, half to death, basically, in that mass transit incident. And I guess, though, in that deal there, I'm not justifying it by any means, but I guess, you know, as a young guy, you know, underage, saying, you know, he was a wrestler, been trained and this and that, just wanted to get into the business. But, and I've been around New Jack, when he was in Smoky Mountain, and, it is a certain amount of respect, you know, that he demands from people and gives people. I'll say that. So, but I guess, Transit was just someone that really might have rubbed Jack the wrong way or whatever. Still no reason to try to kill the guy, but I guess he has sliced that poor boy to death, man.
Yeah.
Like you say, he got an artery, didn't he, in his arm?
Yeah, and they cut an artery in his forehead. You've got that one artery that runs, yeah. Okay. But, I mean, look, that kid should not have been there.
Plain
and fucking simple. And the fact that his dad took him for that, his dad is as culpable as fucking New Jack was in that situation. Yeah. Now, that all being said, you know, New Jack, he got asked to blade the dude, but you know he fucking went as deep as he could. I mean,
yeah.
You know, we've seen guys blade for fucking years and never hit an artery.
Yeah.
You know, look at Brody. You know, when he popped those out of his finger tape and fucking zipped somebody, and that was it. He just got them, and nobody ever bled to death from that.
Yeah. And we were talking last week about Abby, you know, on a program, I think it was, or 2 weeks ago, we were talking about Abby, rather, and we talked about the cheek last week. There's another example, of course, blading. You know, he cut his arm and his head and everything, but go back to Abby, hell, them big scars on his head, he went deep against that ring post, you know.
Yeah.
Pretty damn gruesome, but he did it himself, you know. So,
well, I was going to say, in that situation, at least you're more in control.
Yeah,
I mean, it's probably not something you should want to see in any situation.
No.
And I guess guys like Cowboy Bill Watts, I guess, used to spiff dudes $50 if they got somebody to bleed hard way, too.
Okay.
Let me clarify. I have heard that. That could be bullshit as far as I know. But Cowboy Bill Watts, what we know of him, does that sound like something he wouldn't do or something he would do?
Probably would.
Yeah. I mean, that sounds like, because we know, like, look, he liked big fucking brawler dudes.
Athletic and wrestlers and fighters, you know, so. Let's move on here. Which one you want to pick next we can talk about?
You know what? Since we're already talking about throwing a dude off of a scaffold.
Yeah.
Let's go with this one. I'll let you do it because he's a friend of yours. Yeah.
All right, man. To this day, and I had to watch it last night. I flipped through it twice, but it was the shoot fall of Cornette, Road Warriors Midnight Express. Big Bubba's in a ring, and Cornette basically blew his knees out, and one more so than the other, from my understanding. And then many years I've been around Jimmy, I never talked to him about that or anything like that. But I know when I watched it, and I just knew, I told my brother, I think we were watching together. In fact, I know we were, but I was like, man, he's broken his legs. He blew his knees out or something. Something bad happened. We knew that. And then to hear Cornette talk about it through the years and stuff. But to me, like I said, last night I rewatched it twice, and both times I just was trying to see, you know, where he was at and what, and I just hated seeing his legs. And Jim's like me, you know, we're in this Kentucky weather. By God, we can tell you when it's going to rain or be really cold by the way our knee feels, man.
Yeah.
That's a shoot right there. So, yeah, Corny taking the shoot fall off the scaffold, man, to me, that just crazy because so many things can happen up off that scaffold. And that was one of the early ones that I actually saw, you know, and it's just like, to this day, like, ugh. So I made myself watch it, but I hated seeing it. But I know Cornette came out of it all right, you know, other than, like I said, being able to predict the weather with your knees.
Yeah, he came out a little angrier and a little more bitter, and that was it.
There you go. Yeah.
You know, the scaffold match, that's one of those ones that kind of borders on that, you know, oh, it was a cool idea on paper, and then we did it, and it didn't really work out.
Right. We talked about that during that Road Warrior episode a couple weeks back.
But, you know, it's just one of those ones that almost kind of needs to go with the dog kennel match, you know?
Yeah.
Let's see here. Oh, okay. So I'm going to bring this one up, but I'm also going to say right now there's a GIF going around of Perry Saturn. I think he gets an enziguri and lands on the top of his head on the fall. It looked like he was going for a flip and then just landed on the top of his head. And that reminds me of Benoit throwing Sabu onto the top of his head.
Yeah, man, I saw this several years back. I don't know how long ago, you know, and I honestly don't even know what I was watching. I think I was watching an old ECW show. But anyway, it looked to me, from my understanding, the story behind it is, and if you watch it, folks, it really is gruesome because Sabu gets his neck broken. Mm-hmm. And that's where Chris Benoit was the crippler is what I'm trying to spit out there, Bobby, damn it. But yeah, it looks like he shot him off and Benoit was maybe going for a backdrop and Sabu was taking a bump like a flapjack. So he basically crunched up to go down flat, I guess, and vice versa. And instead of being out flat, he was crunched down, and his head just went straight down into the mat. And you can hear him. Paul is outside the ring, and he said, "He broke my goddamn neck," and he's rolling around out there. And I guess at that point, you know, when it was all said and done, Chris went home, was going to quit wrestling, and Paul, you know, talked him into coming back and gave him that crippler gimmick. But I'm sure that weighed on Chris's mind. No sympathy there. Just saying at that time there was, you know. But, man, just to see Sabu get his neck broken just freaked me the fuck out, man, because, you know, I didn't know if he was going to walk again. Yeah. I saw the way he got out of the ring, and I don't know how severe the break was because, obviously, you know, Sabu's still out there wrestling and probably doing half the crazy shit he used to do anyway. And he's legitimately, you know, just crazy tough, like, you know, getting his arm cut open in Japan and basically rolling out and taping it up and keep on going. But that was one injury where if you go back and watch it, if you look at it close enough, you'll see one was doing one move and the other one was taking a bump for another move. So it just didn't gel right. The body is not supposed to go that way. And it just crunched Sabu's head straight down to the mat.
Oh, yeah. I watched it just before we started this episode. And it's nauseating. I mean, it just, you see it and because you know already that it broke his neck and you're just like, whoa, God.
Yeah.
But, you know, this is shit that I don't want to see anybody get hurt. I mean, there's the initial bloodlust that kicks in. This fucking business you guys do, it's a miracle more people haven't died from a broken neck in the middle of the ring than have, you know, it's just crazy over the top. And then I gotta think Chris Benoit, we're talking about a guy who thought he exposed the business because a suplex didn't go off. So he went and did like 1,000 fucking squats immediately afterwards.
Very intense.
Yeah, and this is because he thought he might have exposed the business. Can you imagine thinking he almost killed somebody?
Yeah, well, eventually he fucking did, so there's that.
Look, I'm trying not to be sympathetic. I know. Yeah.
Me neither. But let me say this. When I was training, you know, Malenko was in his late mid-50s when I met him. And, you know, he was always saying, you know, be careful, do this, do that, and was teaching the very basics, you know, of being safe and taking care of your partner in the ring. Not recently, but in the recent years that I've got to go and help some young guys out, you know, kind of coaching the sidelines, if you will, with the some of the FTC guys and the ASW guys, some of the guys from up here in Nitro, West Virginia, and Ashland, Kentucky, surrounding area here, Ironton, Ohio, et cetera. And I find myself, you know, saying, man, you know, be careful. Don't do something that you don't know how to do, you know. And I find myself more and more telling people, you know, to take care of yourself out there in the ring, be careful, you know. And I think that I never want to see anyone, I don't care if I didn't like them, I don't want to see anyone get injured in the ring, you know, shoot injury. I'll be honest with you, you know, I've been dropped by Big Sid a couple times way back when I was in WCW, right when I was finishing up. And when he broke his leg that we was talking about earlier, I almost wanted to say, you know, it couldn't happen to a nicer guy.
Yeah.
And the asshole of me wanted to say that, but I didn't, because that's the man in and that's the man that's in the chosen profession, and if he, even though he dropped me at one time, pretty risky drop, it was in a handicap match, me and Adrian Bird, and I saw the way he dropped Adrian, and I was supposed to roll out, but he had already grabbed me, so I went with it and dropped me. There's no hard feelings or anything, but I'm thinking, even someone that had done something and had, you know, hurt other people, again, more likely not intentionally, just, you know, carelessness. I didn't want to see that, you know what I'm saying? To go back to that, him breaking his leg. The asshole in me wanted to say that, you know, couldn't happen to a nicer guy, but no. I was like, oh man, that's a fucking athlete and he's fucking hurt. He's hurt bad. I don't want to see anyone in the ring get hurt, man. So it happens. Surprising enough, there's not more broken necks, like you said, and more injuries, but there are a lot of injuries. And believe me, I carry them around for years now. Some of them are more gruesome to others, man. Which one do we, and you can forget and nickname my snide remark there about eventually what I said about Benoit there, but you know, I'm trying not to have any sympathy, but also yeah. We just talk about him getting, you know, how he probably did feel, you know, when he broke Sabu's neck. And that's, if you do watch that, folks, these are all pretty much available on YouTube, and they're pretty damn gruesome. I'm going to go to one, Jeremy, next, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
I thought it was 2005, but it said 2006, and there was a Raw, there was a pay-per-view on a Sunday that my brother had taken his family to up in Ohio. And then the next night, of course, a couple hours later was the a couple hours away was the Raw up there. And so I had particularly watched them. And I don't honestly know if it was the pay-per-view or the Raw, but I knew my brother and his children at the time were going to be in attendance. So I made a special effort to watch them. And again, I was a little bit off on the date, but if you go back to 2006, it's a ladder match, that involving Hardys, and Joey Mercury, his face is bent over the, ladder. And one of the Hardys, when he hits the ladder, oh man, it just basically explodes Joey's face, man. And I'm just like, oh man. So that's one I thought of kind of late, even though we knew we were going to do this list. Last week we had an idea when we were going to do this. That one just came to my mind yesterday while I was out walking, and I come home and looked it up, and that's how I found the date of it. But it's the Joey Mercury ladder incident. Did you catch that, Professor?
I did not see it, but I had heard about it.
Yeah.
So like later on, cause I mean, this was like, he had a pain pill addiction because of this. His face was broken. I mean, this was a colossal level fuck uppery is what this was.
Yeah. It exploded, man. It looked like to me. Well, I watched it, and I probably had not watched it maybe once since then until last night. And I sat down and, you know, kind of made myself go back and watch it. Like I said, I wasn't going to put it on a list. You had texted me, actually asked how I was doing. And I appreciate that. I had been out for a walk, just on a, you know, Saturday afternoon walk. And, listen to music, whatever. And I thought, oh man, whatever happened? Because I knew it was a spot that I'd seen, and that's why I came home and added that one to the list. So and again, I made myself watch it just like I did with the scaffold match, you know. So geez, but if you got a chance, you people are into gruesome stuff, man. You got a lust for a bloodlust or whatever. Feel free to go out there because all these are pretty much on YouTube, if I'm not mistaken. You know, so
Bobby, I know you never really did. I know you did some bloody fucking matches. You know, you headlined Bloody Sunday. Was it Sunday? Bloody Sunday. But how about some of these matches in Japan where they are just like, you know, like that Frontier Martial Arts or XPW here in the States, where it was just like cheese graters and shit. What's your feelings on those?
You know, I'm just going to use the word that comes to mind, of course, is extreme. Mm-hmm. I have been in tape fist matches up in Canada, like basically a brass knuckles match type deal, working with some Cuban Assassin and Leo Burke and some of the guys that were veterans at the time that could lead me through them. I've been in a couple barbed wire matches. I wrestled a Stro in a couple barbed wire matches, as a matter of fact, where one of them, the ring ropes were covered in barbed wire, and another one where the ropes were barbed wire. And those were, you know, about as an extreme as I'd say I got as far as, you know, doing something gimmicky on a show for someone. And luckily, those turned out pretty good, you know. You can get cut pretty bad at barbed wire. Yeah. I got a big gash in my bicep the way it got stuck unintentionally trying to get myself loose. But anyway, my feeling is that's extreme, you know, and I was in Japan. You know, I'd go there. The least I went was 2 weeks, and one summer I went for like 6 weeks. And of course, all the magazines come out. When the magazine come out, I think they come out on a Friday, maybe. I want to say a Tuesday or a Friday. I can't remember. But anyway, they got the nice colored layout magazine and stuff. And they'd go from New Japan, All Japan, to FMW, to Michinoku, and all the different companies in order, you know. Even towards the back, they did WWF and WCW, all the, you know, upkeeps of pro wrestling. And I'd see some of these pictures, man. And of course, I'd hear the boys talking. The Michinoku didn't have those kind of gimmick matches, but some of the guys would tell me, you know, like, you know, what had Terry Funk and Cactus Jack over there doing the boards were exploding, I guess, when you hit the barbed wire, and then it had exploding water. I don't know. I guess it's just to me, especially like when you mentioned earlier on, someone coming through I never understood the fucking, fluorescent light bulbs. I never got that. Cheese graters, like you said, I never got that. I never got, it's maybe because I didn't want to, and I said I never got it.
Yeah.
Because it's like, I'll use your example of, it's not like if I'm going through a store, if you watch the wrestler, the movie, The Wrestler, and Mickey Rourke and the other guys going through a store and they're picking out stuff at the dollar store. Oh, this will work, or hitting herself with aluminum, a pan or whatever. It's like, if you're using the fucking, sledgehammer, you know, you can't go into the ring with a hammer, you know, you're going to kill someone if you bash one with a ball peen hammer, you know, and some of that stuff to me is just, if that's the way you, I don't know, if that's the way you treat your body that extreme, and people are really, really hurting themselves to make people believe they're not hurting themselves. It's the whole fucked up reverse psychology to me, man. That's the way I feel about it. I never had a desire to do it. I did stuff that was in a program, you know, that was okay. This week we're doing this match. This week we're doing this match, and it's going to eventually lead to a tape fist match, or this is going to lead to a barbed wire fist match. You know, this is where it's going to go to. In territory situations, you know, where you worked 6-8 weeks at a time, and you had a program given to you that this is where you're going to go. You know. But as far as just going out there and doing, you know, explosive barbed wire fence matches, and end up in an electric chair or something, no, that's not my deal, man. Ugh. Oh, that's just too gruesome for me.
Well, yeah, that's, you know, there's.
And I have enough injuries without that shit. You can get injured in this sport. Go back to what you said real quickly. Mm-hmm. I have injuries, and these injuries were from just wrestling matches, you know, over and over, and repetition and stuff. So even doing the simplest of things, a man can get hurt in this business, you know.
Oh, yeah. Wear and tear is real, you know.
Yeah.
But, I, you know, I when I was younger, definitely points in the 90s, like when ECW was first hitting, and obviously, you know, there was hardcore wrestling before that, you know, guys like Brody, and you'd see him a lot in like Texas and, you know, NWA, yeah, stuff like that. But you know, when ECW came out, like I was feeling it. I was kind of into it, but then, you know, you keep aging and you start looking at shit and you're like, oh man, that's just fucking ridiculous. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Early on, one of the first things I had got to see, and I got to see it live via tape because that's the way it was broadcast that day, was the concession stand brawl match, you know, the brawls down in Tupelo, Mississippi, and Lance calling it with the Moondogs against Lawler and Dundee. You know, that was I wouldn't say gruesome, but that was kind of extreme hardcore, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Busting, catching bottles of mustard on each other's head. And I think they hit everything but the popcorn machine. I think that was the only thing that they better not tear that damn popcorn machine up, from my understanding, someone said. But, yeah, to me, see, that was more entertaining of a wrestling match and a fight. I really thought they were fighting, so I was entertained by that fight. So see how I'm using that word there? They were still fighting to me.
Yeah.
And I was 15, 16 years old. So I'll throw that one in there too. Now, it's not going to be one of your most gruesome ones to watch, but it will be a fun one to go back and watch for all of our wrestling fans out there for our special Halloween edition this week.
That's right. You know, in those places where they did get bloody back in the day, they saved it for the right occasions, typically. It wasn't just like every match. It was like here and there as it was needed. And in Memphis protected moves too, man, like that pile driver.
Right.
You know, they only let you drop that pile driver when it had to come out. Otherwise, you kept that shit on the shelf, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the thing, like I said, about the tape fist matches I was in Canada. It was a 3 or 4 week program. And this is where it's going to lead to. Barbed wire fence, it was a couple months programming locally. We had about 3 or 4 cities we did, and we built it up each month. It was coming back with something. So it wasn't like, you know, just out of nowhere, hey, I challenge you to a barbed wire match. You know,
yeah,
we let up the stuff, you know, with that. And I think that's the way you do it to build your business. You know what I'm saying? But okay, so I'm gonna throw out this next one that I saw. You probably saw it live too.
Yeah.
About the same time was Mankind on top of the Hell in a Cell match when he's up there with Undertaker and he just goes off the side of that damn cage through the announcer's table. Was he broke in half or not? Is that what JR said? Or someone said, my God, he's broke in half or something. I mean, to me, that was just, I thought the fucking guy was dead, man. I didn't know if it was supposed to happen, if it's planned. When I saw it, I thought, I don't know if I thought gruesome, but I thought, man, I think he's fucking dead.
Well, there are just some,
wicked.
Yeah, there are some impacts. You don't need blood. You see somebody take that fall. You're just like,
yeah.
Fuck. Yeah. Is that the, hold on, am I thinking of a different, what's the one where Terry Funk actually came out to check on him? There was one, Cactus took a fall, no, I think he was Mankind at the time, I think, but he took a fall that was so nasty that even though Terry Funk and he were in a feud, Terry Funk like came out of the dressing room to go check on him because it just looked that bad. I don't think it was this one.
Well, see, there was another one where this one I thought was actually worse. Actually, I should say could have been worse. And I've heard the Undertaker side of it on the on the Stone Cold podcast. They're both on top of the cell, and this is a different match, and it breaks, and Mankind falls through it.
Yeah.
If he falls through it, and there's a chair in the ring, and if he hit just about as perfect as you could hit when that thing broke. I'm sure he didn't think he hit perfect when he did that night. But if he'd hit that chair with his neck or anything, it could have been, you know, more serious, more gruesome than what it was. So it may have been that one. I don't know. I don't recall, Terry coming out to either one of them. But I'm not doubting you're telling me that it's true, too. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That it's something. I do know this. The reason I remember it was Mankind talking about the Undertaker. That's who it was. I said it the wrong way. It was Mankind or Cactus Jack was talking about the Undertaker on Stone Cold podcast. He said what kind of athlete he was. There's I'm sitting there thinking, having sympathy for him because he took that big bump through the ring that particular match. He said, I'll tell you what kind of athlete Mark Calaway is, the Undertaker, because he said he actually had a twisted ankle pretty bad, and he still comes down from top of that cage and has to drop. He hangs down but drops and has to land on that foot in that ring on a bad ankle. And he's sitting there putting the other guy over. Here he is, just come through there. That's tough as fuck. And then he's still putting over the Undertaker, talking about how tough he is by having to land on a sprained ankle, you know. Mm-hmm. And that does hurt if you have to land on a sprained ankle. But that just shows their damn toughness for this business. And it wouldn't surprise me if it wasn't more than one match that Terry Funk had to probably come out and check on Cactus Jack or Mick Foley, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Those older guys, like guys older than us, obviously. Like when we were talking to Ron, they don't break kayfabe. Matter of fact, you talk to guys now that are that generation, they still don't let you in on the fucking, on the background. Yeah. They still just like, nope, we talk about it like we always talked about it. So for Terry Funk to come out, I'm going to have to find out which one that is, but we'll do that.
Please do.
But for him to come out and do that, he must have really thought shit had gone fucked up.
Right. And if you want to, wrestling fans, you know what you can do? You can hit us up on Twitter and let us know if you recall which match that is, or if you have a gruesome match or moment, please send it to us. I'm at BobbyBlaze744. Jeremy's at The Geekest Cast. And then we got our joint account on Twitter, and it's at Bell to Bell Blaze. And there's also a Bell to Bell Blaze over on Facebook as well. And we also have a YouTube channel, since we've been talking about a lot of YouTube here. We had last year, if you remember, we had the Muta blood scale on there.
Yep.
We done one for Halloween. There's just to throw it out at you that Tex had put up. It's tinyurl.com/BBBBvideo. If you go to that, you can see some of our past videos, and some of the ones on there are most scariest gimmicks for Halloween, most scariest matches for Halloween, and now we'll be adding the most gruesome moments in wrestling, if you will, on this podcast. I just wanted to get that out there, Jeremy.
Yep, absolutely. Well, I'm still trying to figure out what to do about the YouTube page. I am going to start an official one. I talked to YouTube a little bit, and I may have to copyright strike the Texas old page, which I really don't fucking want to do.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to figure that out, and I'm also trying to figure out how to put new videos together, because I'm not going to do as good a job as Tex did. Just plain and simple.
He's done a great job.
Yeah, it's not going to happen, but I want to do something because, you know, we reach such a big audience with YouTube that we have to be on there, you know?
Yeah, we do. And if there's anyone out there, if there's another Tex Johnson out there, you know, that knows how to do what he could do, we'd appreciate it very much. We was very blessed to have him come on board with us after several, I don't even know, four or five episodes, man. And he become a friend of the show, and a fan of the show at first, and then a friend of the show, to where he started sending us videos and asked, could he put them on YouTube? So there's, just so you know where that's at, where that stands, basically. You know, we lost Tex a few weeks back, a couple months now, I guess.
Yeah.
And he had the whole account set up, with Jeremy and myself agreeing to, you know, use our voices, et cetera. And he was putting together these wonderful videos. And again, that's at tinyurl.com/BBBBvideo. The thing is, he dropped off about last year during football season, during the pro wrestlers that were pro football players episodes. But we were fortunate enough that he'd done several of the greatest announcers of all time, the greatest regional heels, the greatest baby faces. Like we said, legitimate badasses. That has the most views of all of them combined, probably. But we've got about, I think it's 1.6 million views on that YouTube channel, and it's just sitting there right now. So we won't be adding anything to that, but Jeremy is in a process of working out, like, as you heard him say, another YouTube page. So if anyone's out there is a fan of the show, I'd like to become a friend of the show and help us out along the way, or help Professor out, that'd be great. If not, we appreciate you going back and watching the old stuff. We appreciate you listening to today's program, man. we're growing every week on our program. We appreciate y'all staying with us each and every week, man. We're just good old wrestling fans, and we'd love to hear from you. Like I said, on our Twitter accounts, that's the easiest way to get a hold of me. Just hit me up at BobbyBlaze744. Let us know what you think, man. We mentioned last week we had a couple more reviews, and we appreciate those. I read a couple of them off of iTunes. I'm sure there's some other ones on Spotify and Stitcher and some of the other different ways you might be listening to this podcast. But no matter how you're listening to it, by God, we appreciate it, especially the real wrestling fans.
Yeah.
Anyway.
That is absolutely true. Absolutely true. I know we're
about done with these gruesome. We pretty much covered all of them. They weren't any top 10 order per se. We just kind of had an outline to go with. I will say this, if you have some gruesome footage and stuff, you want to send it out, don't send that to me. Send it to the joint account. Really, I just don't want to see people getting hurt, man.
Yeah, I'll watch it. I can tell you right now, yeah, you got a gruesome match.
Well, I'm going to watch it. Don't get me wrong. I'll watch it over on the Bell to Bell Blaze Twitter account, not my personal one. I don't want to see it on my personal one is what I'm saying.
Yeah. There's some that, you know, every time somebody's like, oh, hey, did you see that time so-and-so landed on the top of their head? Or fuck, you watch it, that first second, you're like, holy shit. And then you're like, oh, holy shit. Oh, God.
Man. So, anyway, listen, I'm probably not giving out any fucking Halloween candy this year. I'm going to be social distancing myself. I'll wear a mask. That's for damn sure. But I'll have my lights out of my house. Probably park my car down a street somewhere or something. I don't know. I usually don't get a lot of people anyway. I'll probably give some to these neighborhood kids that I know that just up and down my street here, but no stragglers, man. I'm going to be in on Halloween night, probably watching like something like the Rocky Horror Picture Show or something, man. That's kind of my deal. But for all you, ghosts and goblins and jack-o'-lanterns and cool cats and whatever you want to be this year, you know, go out there and have fun. But whatever you do, man, be fucking safe. You know, wear a mask, social distance yourself, and take care of yourself. That's what I'll say. Yep. If you're going trick-or-treating or trick-or-trunking or whatever you're going to be doing.
Yep. Wear a mask under your mask or over your mask, but wear a mask. Yep. Keep a couple feet between you and especially people you don't live with.
Yep.
You know, here's the thing, guys. You know, I know this is all like a big inconvenience, whatnot. I can actually point to a fucking burial ground right now where my grandmother who died of polio is and my cousin who died of HIV complications is. Viruses are serious shit, okay? And I know I keep hearing people do this. Well, they didn't die of COVID. They had diabetes. Okay, well, 40% of Americans are overweight. Okay, being overweight is a comorbidity for this disease. Also, AIDS never killed anybody. People die of the cold and the flu and pneumonia and the shit you get while you have it. So don't focus on, oh, it only kills this many people, because you're not looking at the right numbers. And if everybody would keep a couple feet between them and the next guy and wear a mask when they're out in public, life would be mostly back to normal by now if we'd been doing that all along.
Yeah.
So That's my one rant. I'm getting off my soapbox now.
So I'm going to put you back on one more, okay?
Okay.
Did we mention it this episode? It might have been last episode, because I tell you, by the time this one here comes out, you got time to go vote on November 3rd, folks.
Yes.
It's your civic duty. So go vote. So we're talking about Halloween. One end rant on that, and my rant on this is just this. I don't care who you vote for. Just get out there and vote. I've already mailed my vote in last Thursday, and I'm proud that I've done that.
Yeah, it's important. Look, we live in a representative democracy. It is important that your voice is heard, and we have a way to do it. We just need to do it, and it's shameful how little we vote in this country.
Yeah.
Oh, Bobby, I don't like feeling like I'm talking down to our audience, though.
No, we're not, man. I think we got a pretty educated audience, not just in wrestling terms, but, you know, just in life in general. I really do.
Yeah.
From some of the feedback I get just on my Twitter account, you know, I interact with people in there all the time. And I think for the most part, they're educated. I don't mean like maybe necessarily book smart or wrestling smart. I just think they're educated and having some damn common sense and knowing that when Bobby or Jeremy's talking, just having a good time. But if they say something, you know, about going and taking the time to get out and vote and stuff, that we're being serious, you know. But with that said, Jeremy, I'm just going to get ready to get off here. Please, people, take care of each other. I hope you liked our gruesome list. That was gruesome for me to fucking watch some of it. I'll tell you, I cringed, and that's a shoot, man. And anyway, take care of each other. Wear your face mask. Social distance. And be kind to yourself. You know, give yourself a break sometimes mentally, because it's tough times right now out there. And, man, all kinds of shit just runs through your head. Stuff that happened in grade school or something you said to someone will come up and say, where the hell did that conversation come from? You know, I'm sitting there going, it's time to get – I got to go for a walk and clear my head sometimes, man. So, please, your mental health, take care of it just like you do your physical health. And have a happy Halloween and get out there and vote.
That's right. And, you know – we will be back with, was this going to be season 6?
Yep.
And I, you know, I'm really, really excited about our first episode from that season.
Oh yeah, man. That's going to be a good one. Yeah. We'll be back on a regular format in a couple weeks, folks.
Yep.
Be cool. We got a good first one to open up season 6 with. We sure do.
Can I tease it?
Sure.
Playboy Gary Hart.
Ah, yes.
Yeah.
Man, you dropped that name during one of the segments when we was doing, I think it's Brody or Bam Bam or someone, and we like, oh, put that one down. That's got to be a topic soon. And so yeah. That's kind of also a teaser, Jeremy, mm-hmm. As to where our next season's heading.
It is.
So there you go. But yeah, Playboy Gary Hart, that should be an interesting one.
Oh, I'm really looking forward to that one. Right, Bobby, you want to wrap up on anything?
No, man. Thank you. Take care. Be careful, brother.
All right. So, everybody, for Tex Johnson, myself, Professor Jeremy Vilmer, and Bobby Blaze, happy Halloween. Get out and vote. Bye-bye, everybody.